Hello and welcome to IEEE Soft Robotics Podcast. In this podcast, we are going to interview researchers from both academia and industry about their work, Salt Spectrum, and more beyond that. This is Marwa Edwini, and I hope you will find this podcast useful. If you would like to connect with us, simply send us, and we will be happy to hear from you. And here is my interview. Thanks.
Hello and welcome to IEEE Soft Robotics Podcast. Hello, Professor Kara. Thank you so much for joining us in the podcast. I would like to ask you how you would like to define yourself for the audience who may be first time listening to you.
All right. Well, thanks, Marwa, for inviting me here. It's a real pleasure to be part of this podcast. How to define me? I would say I'm a professor of mechanical engineering and of applied physics at the California Institute of Technology. And I have a deep interest in developing new materials for different engineering applications that span from sensors to actuators, robotic surfaces, and medical devices.
Wonderful. Yeah. So I'm curious about your childhood. How was your childhood was being interested in much of technology as a kid? Do you have any memories about that?
Of course I have memories. I had a very happy childhood. I was always very curious. I was always very dynamic and somewhat of a fearless child. I think I had a lot of freedom in my childhood, freedom to build, freedom to travel. It was very different then. I grew up in Italy where, the concept of helicopter parenting was non-existent at the time. So I had a lot of free time and a lot of free space to roam around the neighborhood, build contraptions, design system structures, houses, components. And in the rainy days, I spent endless hours playing Legos. I guess that's what got me where I am now.
Wonderful, wonderful. So do you remember what's the first maybe material you designed or maybe develop a new material, maybe before grad school? Do you remember any of this?
I mean, as in terms of like play or in terms of research, like at what stage in career life are you thinking?
Maybe both, if you can tell the play and the research as well.
You know, in terms of play, I spent a lot of time outside, and I was fortunate to have, space that was unused. So it was not constructed areas. It was not a park that was neatly maintained. Mm-hmm. There was a lot of junk all over that was lying around, and I could just put things together, from combining soil and messy materials and leaves I would find around, all the way to components of chairs that people would leave out. And I remember I loved to build structures where I could climb and play with. I think that maybe now has shrank to, in my current research, these structures became more the structured materials that are designed and built with a purpose and more knowledge of mechanics, but the enthusiasm and the energy in doing them didn't change.
Wow, wonderful. So maybe because what maybe is the most interesting thing about material science? We knew, because if you define what is material and what do you think something was very fascinating about material science, what are you working?
Right. I think the first time I really got passionate about materials and material science was back in undergrad, in which during my undergraduate degrees in mechanical engineering in Italy, I somehow had the sense that materials were the seeds of technological innovations. Even if you think about it in terms of historical progression of ages, in the history of humankind, we call it, the Stone Age, the Bronze Age, the Iron Age. And it was always determined by the fact that we as humans, engineers, creators have been able to either extract new materials or design new materials or alloy new materials in different ways that, enabled progress, like the relatively economic production of steel enabled the Industrial Revolution and so on and so forth. And so I figured, if I could develop the materials of the future, I was asking myself, what kind of technological innovations would be possible? And so back then I specialized in materials, and especially the university where I went had a program in metallurgy. So I tried to take as many materials and solid mechanics courses I could take before graduation, and then continued on as a master's and PhD students at UC San Diego, specializing in material science.
Mm-hmm. Great, great. So maybe I'm just to ask you, how you see the definition of material in the context of soft robotics? How do you see them as passive or active? If you can't see, tell us what you see in that area.
I think soft robotics really offer an enormous opportunity for merging two separate disciplines that so far have been, in a way, somewhat silosed into two different groups of scientists and researchers, material science and roboticists. And why I say that is that soft robotics intrinsically require the development of materials that are highly deformable, materials that are often nonlinear in their responses, but also multifunctional. They combine, for example, responsiveness to external stimuli like temperature, humidity, chemical environment, or electrical fields. And those type of multifunctionalities require, you know, very complex designs of control systems, for example. So I think this merging of advancing new materials, designing materials with unprecedented properties with the field of controls and dynamical systems mm-hmm. are, you know, essential, almost equally important in the development of soft robotics. So where for soft robotics, we think of robots that can deform and interact with the surrounding environment in a safe way, but they may also combine other functionalities like shape morphing, like color changing, as well as locomotion and grasping and gripping that, you know, are also possible with conventional robots today.
Mm-hmm. So maybe a quick question, because I ask this question all the time. Do you think we have deep understanding of the material when it comes to modeling and how they behave? Do you think we have deep understanding for that?
You know, I think mechanics of materials have come really a long way. However, there are still phenomenal challenges in understanding materials at the fundamental level, especially at the level that would be required for soft robotics. Let me think about, you know, some of the challenges that come to mind in the mechanics of materials is, you know, understanding fundamental concepts like what is the non-local coupling between deformations, the superposition of functions in the stresses and strain field. You know, how do you predict or design for nonlinearity and multi-stability, or what is the impact of materials chemistry and composition on the mechanical properties and or functional properties you want to get? And so I think until we get a fundamental understanding of those properties and fundamental concepts, it's very hard to have tools that allow for design. And that's what I find tricky, especially as an experimentalist, is the lack of predictive design tools that allow you to solve the so-called inverse problem. Right? To say, I need to have, for example, a robotic octopus, right? But how how do we design it? It's still hard because we don't know the fundamental functions that govern these complex behaviors.
Mm-hmm. Do you think maybe modeling here is not maybe not discovered very well what kind of level of modeling we have to go for? Which tool do you think is very beneficial here?
It's hard to say. I think modeling, you know, right now, the tools we use, I would say, in modeling are tools that are quite exact in the sense of predicting, for example, the mechanical responses. I'm thinking like the ubiquitous use of finite element. However, you know, as a design tool, finite element is a hard one to use because it's very computationally expensive, right? So solving the famous inverse problem, when you want to design a structure and you don't know how the structure is supposed to look like, it's very hard. It's just simply not efficient enough, not sustainable from a computational costs point of view. So on the other hand, you know, other tools like discrete order models that are often more efficient lack the ability to map often one-on-one with specific geometries of the structure, if you think of a composite material, for example. So I think there is a place where, you know, there is a gap of knowledge there, where I think we can learn to develop new models that perhaps marry the best of both worlds, the continua and the discrete, perhaps learning from data, right? There's an explosion of data-driven tools nowadays that are in a way exalting and hype towards new methods for design and computing. And I mean, I'm an experimentalist, and I have great hopes on the advancements of computational science, because I feel like today, as experimentalists, we are a little stuck in an Edisonian world of experimental design, where we think of something, we're like, oh, this should work, you try it, and then it doesn't work, and then you change it a little, and it's just not very efficient, and it doesn't necessarily lead to an optimum.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing that. I think this is all very excellent point. And I think, yeah, we still have a limitation here and gaps. Mm. So I'm curious to ask you about the material design and the structure, because I think it's very interesting how this morphology and the structure is also interesting in the behavior. And I see you're doing a really great job in this line, because no one just is really explain how the structure goes hand in hand with the material design and gimme changing the geometries we select. When it comes to, for example, combining two material, what kind of geometry for the other material we have to embed in the other material? So we didn't find somehow studies about that to reduce risk concentration or having interesting information for multi-material. Yeah.
Yeah, you touched right on the hot spot here. I feel like you're right. I mean, I think the last decade or so has seen an explosion of these advances and developments of ever more complex 3D structured materials. Mm. And I think, that has been made possible by advances in manufacturing. Like now there are 3D printers that can, 3D print multi-material in impossibly or vastly varying scales, from nanometers to concrete, that can 3D print houses. And I think everything in between is covered, right? So we can 3D print and fabricate very complex geometries with different materials, and sometimes combining different materials. You can 3D print composites, for example. I think the challenge there is what you mentioned, which is, but how to choose, which material goes where and what is the optimal geometry? And I think that's perhaps still where the biggest challenge is. It goes back to the question we discussed before of the computational tools and how can we combine topology optimization that determines the geometry of the microstructure or the structure of the material and the material optimization that determines what constitutive properties of what materials should go in every voxel of this three-dimensional space. I think that's still a challenge that's completely open. So especially for those of us in the community or all the people in the community developing numerical models, that's certainly an exciting gap to fill.
Yeah. I'm going to ask you, Professor Karan Dakke, because you have both expertise in computational science and material science. What could be significant parameters you have to look for in this problem? Because sometimes we have this kind of communication between material science and robotics, so it's tricky sometimes to figure out what could be the significant parameters you have to consider in that case.
What do you mean for parameters?
Like young models, mechanical parameters, or electrical, which is, I think, is very significant to you in that case.
Yeah, actually, this is a question I get asked a lot, because the question is, more than parameters, I'm thinking, what is the function we want to optimize, right? I think in many of the papers I see, and we're doing the same in my own group, many of the papers try to target exotic properties. Like we started talking about negative Poisson's ratio or multifunctionalities, but the question is, maybe coming from a more practical side, is what do we really need, especially in the robotic sense, right? And what type of soft robots are the ones that we want to target first? And for example, is it something like a soft exoskeleton that augments humans' mobility, or is it something that mimics, for example, the natural world by camouflaging in the environment, right? And I think depending on what is the function and what is the objective here, the practical applications, we can then determine the so-called prompts or functionalities that we want to optimize for and design for. But until we know exactly what problem we're trying to solve, it's hard to say, oh, Young's modulus is more important than, say, stiffness or transparency. I think those are very much a function of the problem we're trying to solve here.
Mm-hmm. Interesting, yeah. So if you just ask you about the geometric nonlinearities and the material nonlinearities, how do you see the coupling both of them in an interesting way to have this maybe, yeah, replacing as a control? Because you speak about how we can design a material that can play at the machine. So how do you see the geometric and pneumatic nonlinearities? You can explore them in an interesting way.
So I have a soft spot in my heart for nonlinearities. That's been what really was the beginning of my career since I was a PhD student, was to deal with, you know, these geometric nonlinearities in particular. I remember back then I was studying contact problems between particles. And I was fascinated by the richness of the mechanical phenomena that arise when you are able to control nonlinearities. You know, in many engineering designs to date, if you look at the objects around us, you see that we tend to swipe the nonlinearity under the rug because nonlinearity is scary. It's often unpredictable. It's hard to model, and it can lead to chaotic / catastrophic events that are undesirable. And so far, we tend to linearize everything and say, no, the system is linear. Everything is predictable. Elasticity is there for us to help. And I think that if we learn to tame nonlinearity and use it to our advantage in design, then a lot of new properties, a lot of new functionalities can be embedded even in a single material system. And this is true for both material nonlinearities, which are nonlinearities that arise in the constitutive response of a material, like think about rubber elasticity, as well as geometrical nonlinearities like buckling that can be phenomenally useful when you're trying to create something that's soft and that can shape more. The hard part here, the challenge is how to tame them, right? And it goes back once again to being able to model them, because today there are not really good tools, neither analytical nor computational, that can deal easily, I mean, cost effectively, so fast and easily in terms of capturing the real behavior, that can deal with either large deformations that come from rubber elasticity or buckling instabilities. These are super challenging problems to compute in the forward model, let alone to design for in the inverse model.
Yeah. And do you think how it could be replaced a machine? For example, could be a controller itself. What's your thought about the traditional control we use already? Can we replace it?
No, I see your question. You're saying, you know, can the material replace the controls, basically? And I think to a certain extent, for simple functionalities, it is possible to envision embedding within the constitutive response of materials a control. Where here a control, I'm thinking of a time-dependent response of the constitutive material. Think about, you know, this has been known for decades, right? If you think about creep in many polymeric systems, you know, there is a known time-dependent response of polymers to, for example, temperature or radiation or solar exposure or whatever. So I think we can learn to exploit some of these time-dependent responses in materials that can also arise from materials that are active, like liquid crystal elastomers or shape memory polymers or even shape memory alloys and metals, and then embed those functionality within parts of structured materials. So this increases the complexity, but allows to incorporate in the materials design also this time-dependent response. So whenever you have an actuation that's time-dependent, it starts to go towards a set of, you know, thinking of controls that allows for specific deformations. I think distributing controls within the material would make the overall robotic system eventually simpler to design and operate.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Great point. So maybe I'm curious here, what could be the area or direction do you think when it comes to robotics? So you think it's very important, but we don't give much attention. I think your research line is still maybe not common. It's very interesting and very important, but how do you see the overall picture of the field? Do you think we are going maybe in the right direction? Or do you think something very interesting or very important and we're not addressing in practical way, like the very important question. This is very important, but we still neglect it. Do you have any sort like that?
You know, I don't consider myself a roboticist. So I really do come to the field of robotics, especially soft robotics, as a newbie here. I really try to think about my contribution and my research contribution to the field as a supplement to the existing robotics tool and design tools, which really comes from the material side of things. Mm-hmm. And so, of course, I'm a little biased towards this concept of incorporating advanced materials and structured materials and responsive materials into robotic systems that I think in a classical sense have mostly dwelled into rigid body components with actuators, hence separating the worlds of materials from the worlds of robot actuation and structural, for example, components. I think we're only scratching the surface of what the merge of this materials design world with the robotics world can achieve once we understand how to design. So I think the numerics is a big challenge, and how to manufacture this complex robotic system that combine different materials, different responsivity, maybe even different actuation methods that can combine partially soft and partially rigid actuation and so on. I think we're only at the very beginning, and there is an enormous space for contributing to the field when we learn to combine materials and robotics together.
Great, great. So maybe a student could be curious, ask you, when you design, because you're curious about designing new material, what's the first step you think about designing new material? You have bio inspiration, for example, you speak about that. But I guess you have deep understanding about this designing process. So what's the first step you think about designing new material?
I think there's not a unique answer to that question. I think the answer is that, well, it depends. It depends on what problem we are trying to solve, right? So in general, the first step is to ask ourselves, what would be interesting? What would be revolutionary to have? What would be exciting to see a material do for us? And sometimes it helps to think outside the boxes and to challenge definitions. Like sometimes, when 3D printing came about and we started to create these architected materials, the novelty is 10, 15 years ago, right? Was we can blur the boundary between what the structure is in civil engineering and what a material is in material science or solid mechanics, right? We can blur it because we can make structures so small that the material itself becomes a structure. And then what we used to think of a foam now becomes a structured material. And that was, that was a revolution back then, because we were able to create them with 3D printers. Now I'm thinking, what blurs the boundary between a material and a robot? What is really that distinguish these two things when you start actuating deformations locally and allowing materials to change shape by themselves or even locomote and move by themselves? Mm-hmm. So challenging definitions and challenging, I guess, common sense and common knowledge, I think it's helpful when trying to create materials that behave kind of out of the box. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the question is, what do we want to challenge exactly? Like, do we want something that all of a sudden is able to shape morph in different ways with simple actuation? Or are we trying to do something that can adapt its energy absorption according to the external threats? I think it's again linked to what is the problem we want to solve, and then let's brainstorm about what kind of architectures we know of from fundamental mechanics would be helpful to begin designing from, and then you iterate from there.
Yeah. And maybe related here, what could be an avoidable trade-off, something you have to give up in certain maybe problem to your try to design, if you have something in mind? something you have to give up sometime is you can't avoid this trade-off. Do you have a scenario like that, an avoidable trade-off in the design?
Yeah, I think in my mind, the unavoidable trade-off is accuracy of predictions in computation versus speed and efficiency. Again, I'm going back to this idea of finite element, right? Finite element is an approach that is known to be exact. We know that, you know, it converges. There are theorems that can prove convergence when the mesh refines itself to infinitesimal points to the theory of continua, and it gives exact solutions that are provably right. I think the problem, though, is that when you're looking for such level of exactness, you are trading off the ability to include complexity into your design, into your element, into your structure, into whatever you are designing. That's where I, at the beginning of this discussion, like I mentioned, you know, reduced order models or other approximations, where you're going to trade off some of the precisions with, you know, but with the advantage of saying, well, but look at the complexity. I can create something that's incredibly hierarchical and interacts, for example, with the fluid and with temperature and so on and so forth, which would just not be feasible in an exact finite element framework. So that's what I would be willing to trade off for design capability.
Mm-hmm. Great. So maybe also a quick question about the trade-off, because sometimes, for example, any conductive polymer and the categories, sometimes there's a trade-off between the mechanical performance and the response time. Do you see sometimes the robotic is way too slow? I don't know, maybe it's a general question. So maybe, yeah, we try to maybe see that there's trade-off between the response time for soft robotics and the forces. And maybe a blatant example, an anti-conductive polymer, and this, the power and the response time and the mechanical performance, how we can solve this problem and make it smart material that have the both properties at the same time, the high mechanical performance and response time.
Yeah, again, that's something that often comes to mind. There's a question of, either you use something that uses very little energy. Like I'm thinking, again, going back to my own research, we've used in the past liquid crystal elastomers, glacially slow, but, very simple to use in terms of just you heat them up and they deform, right? But they're very slow, although they require little power. And, the forces of actuations are arguably not so high. I think that we're not at that stage yet to worry about speed and force amplitude, because I think there is still so much we can do in terms of designing better materials, better structures, better robots, before we can really worry about, are they fast enough? Because the question then goes back to, but fast enough for what? You know, if our point is to just demonstrate, I want to create a material that can shape morph, unless I know exactly what application in an industrial context, in a medical context, or in an architectural context, I want this material to be useful for, I don't need to worry about speed. I can just kind of try to design the material with an actuation to prove a concept that this integration of architected materials and robotics can lead to advances in the field. Mm-hmm. Only once we pinpoint, okay, I really need to make this object swim fast, for example, because I need it to deliver mail underwater, then I can start worrying about what kind of faster actuation or what better power performance or power efficiency can I design? I think there are level of complexity that one needs to tackle separately. There is the proof of concept that says I can incorporate soft architected deformable material in a robot and show the novelty in the functionalities that such approach would allow. And then we can say, now that I know that, for example, I need this for a medical robot, let's try to speed up the actuation to get to where I need to get. And I think the way to do that is to, look around the material science world, where people continuously develop active polymers, active materials, active composites, even threads that can be actuated with relatively low power that can, they're starting to become ever more advanced and ever more performing. So maybe the perfect actuator is not existing today, but that doesn't worry me. I'm I know I'm trying to solve one problem at a time. And I think the speed and efficiency of powering is something that will be tackled in due time.
Mm-hmm. Maybe I'm curious about the challenges you try to address in your lab. Something very interesting, maybe project you aspire to address in your lab, and it's still challenging at the same time for your research. What could be that topic?
A challenge on a, in the, you mean you're thinking what is the next advanced material?
Yeah. My and also dream. Also the challenges. Yeah.
I think we have shown in a lot of the soft robotic system or robotic surfaces and the recent advances that my group has been doing, we have shown that incorporating architectured materials with actuation of different ways, responsiveness and so on, can really lead to surprising functionalities. However, the next step I would like to see is to try to incorporate in the material a feedback. So not just say, if hot, then fold, and if hotter, then roll. That's fine. It proves a point that you can embed responsivity and time-dependent control in a material. I think it's a great start. But in the future, I would like to see the material respond itself to external stimuli. So try to add a complexity in this response that says, well, if hot, and then pause, wait, am I hot enough? And then try to get effectively some, not just the actuation, but the sensing part also embedded in the material, so we can distribute sensing and distribute awareness within the material itself. I think right now we're able to distribute actuation in different parts. I think what would be really need to see is distribute actuation and sense, so that we can close the loop of controls.
That's a very interesting point. I'm curious to ask you, because when the field we speak of time sensing, embedding sensing is so challenging when it comes to, if we speak about smart material that any conductive polymer can be sensor active at the same time. But if you tell us about the challenging part of what you try to achieve to embed the sensing, what are the challenging here?
Well, the challenge is that I don't want to embed a spaghetti balls of wires. So I'm not thinking about embedding sensors by saying, okay, I'm going to put a pressure sensor here, a temperature sensor here, and then a light sensor there, and then have this kind of zoo of wires that are going to be covering my poor little soft robot. I think the challenge is to see whether we can have materials that incorporate this responsivity and this sensitivity in the constitutive response themselves, where I'm thinking of some materials that can self-tune the response by saying, if I'm hot, then I'm folding, but if it's too hot, then I fold back, or effectively trying to have a more complex responsivity in the composite that functions as a sensor and functions as a controller unit that then adjusts the behavior of the material locally according to the external stimuli. That, of course, increases the complexity of the material design even more, but I think it would be really exciting to see that.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you for saying that, yeah. So at closing the end, I have a few questions. The first one, do you think about selection material should be about better functionality or maybe fabrication, easy to fabricate when it comes to decision for that?
Well, I'm biased here because I definitely find it more interesting to prove new functionality. So I'm much more excited to see materials behave in an impossible way, in a surprising way, than ask myself, but how do I make it in a large scale, or how do I manufacture it in an industrial setting? I think they're both important, especially if you really want to solve a problem in a commercial application. But I guess what drives our own research group is more the quest for new functionalities.
Mm-hmm. And I'm curious to ask you, do you have any situation like you thought something would work out perfectly in modeling, maybe in your thinking, and an empirical result was something counterintuitive or surprising result? You didn't expect that.
It happens all the time. I think some of the most exciting results, even in, I'm thinking in a recent past from my own group came from inexplicable experimental behaviors. Like, we were trying to get something and we're like, well, this is supposed to be linear. And all of a sudden, this thing is just behaving in a different way. And you start kind of hitting your head around the why. You know, why is the experiment different than what I expect? And those sometimes are the why moments are when you really, then they turn into wow moment, in which the discovery of some really new phenomenon, something unexpected, then leads to new functionalities or new devices and so on. And I think I can think of, you know, several examples in my own, you know, past research where these things have led to exciting new research directions.
Yeah, great. So maybe I have here a question about the risk and ideas, because we speak all the time about the risk and idea and incremental progress, for example. And I'm curious to ask you, in your journey about having a risk and idea, do you have this kind of fear because you need to have publication, for example? How you manage to do that between, you are so passionate and curious, and also, yeah, the publication, for example. So if anyone's just a junior in the research and you have risk idea or you want to do that, and you have publication pressure here as well. I don't know how you see the situation here.
Yeah, I think that that answer, you know, had you asked me that question maybe, you know, 15 years ago, the answer would be different. But today, I don't think so much about that. I think publications are an important step in communicating the findings. I think of them as an essential part of our job as scientists and researchers, to communicate to the rest of the world that, hey, there's this amazing discovery we have done, but I don't see them as my ultimate goal. In fact, I see them as a step in the process, that when we find something out, okay, let's write it up and communicate it and move on. So I don't feel this pressure of publishing anymore at all. Mm-hmm. I'm much more excited, and you know, what gets me up in the morning is really the challenge of saying, what are we going to discover today? You know, what's going to be the new idea that the lab can tackle? And that comes from interacting with amazing students and postdocs that we're really fortunate to have at Caltech. Yeah. I think, of course, that was different when I was at the beginning of my career, when I was an assistant professor. You know, it was clear that I shouldn't just pursue fantastic ideas. I should also show that there is a certain level of progress.
Yeah.
And so maybe at the very beginning, the first couple of years in my tenure track, I chose to pursue projects that were, I was fairly secure of being able to complete. You know, just maybe they were exciting, but they weren't departing too wildly out of my comfort zone of, you know, background knowledge and maybe PhD work and so on. But I became ever more daring, you know, as the years passed, and now, you know, the question of publishing is really not even in my mind really anymore. I think it's important for the students and the postdocs, so that, you know, they themselves can start a career and so on. But
absolutely. Yeah. And maybe I'm curious about maybe a moment in your research was challenging and turned to ultimate success. Do you have any moments challenging in the research you do or ideas? And turn the ultimate success.
You know, I can't think of any project that didn't go through multiple stages of challenges and despair. I cannot think of a single one that didn't have challenges. I think, you know, I like to describe the research project as kind of like this wave of like really deep valley of nothingness, in which you try this, it doesn't work, you try that, it doesn't work, you have another idea, doesn't work either. And you just kind of get stuck, right? You try to run the code and something is just not, you know, there is this glitch that doesn't get resolved no matter what you do. And I feel like they're more often than not the norm. There is only, you know, once in a while that you solve everything and all the planets align and all of a sudden you have this, yes, you know, it's working. We just made something new and those are rare, but you know, they're like these really high peaks and then there are the deep valleys. You just, I think it's just how research is.
And maybe what I'm curious to ask you, what is maybe the most important quality you have gained while being in this journey? And you have to maintain most important.
Resilience. I think you know, how dealing with these requires resilience. But resilience is, you know, if it's paired with passion, it's almost an unbeatable combination. I think, you know, if you're excited about what you do, you're passionate about this, you become resilient in when traversing these valleys of failures, right? And I think just being aware and cognizant that this is just how science works. So if you are in one of these valley, you know, move over, do another thing, go hiking or start another project. Mm-hmm. And when you come back or you return to that valley, you probably have fresher ideas. So the ability to reinvent yourself and adjust dynamically to the adversities, I think it's something that I find to be most useful.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Yeah. And lastly, what was the best advice I was given to you and was the life changing?
Wait, what is the best advice I was given to?
Yeah, and was the life changing?
And was it life changing? That's the question. That's a good one. You know, I think initially when I was a student and even when I was a, when I was a beginner, a graduate student, I wasn't sure I wanted to be in science. I think I was lucky to have many mentors that instilled in me this love for science, this passion for pursuing the unknown and for asking challenging questions, but they can also have, you know, reachable answers. And I think, I don't think there was one advice that I was given that has changed my life, but I think it was the constant support of these mentors, the constant feedback that I got from many people throughout my career that really nurtured my growth. And I think I feel very lucky to have had exceptionally good mentors and colleagues and peers throughout you know, my different stages of academic life.
Wonderful, yeah. And may I ask you if you have any final words you'd like to say for soft robotics community? Any final words you'd like to say?
I think soft robotics is really a new frontier that challenges us in many different ways, from fundamental materials advances to controls and applications. And I hope many of the younger people will become interested in it and will join the force.
Thank you. So thank you once again, Professor Kiart. It was very inspiring. And thank you for doing this great work and an inspiration for students and me and Setha. Thank you. It's such an honor to have you. Thank you.
Thanks, Marwa. It's great to meet you and to be part of this.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me.